I don't know if this is just me, but every once in a while, I'll see something that is so cheap that I have to buy it no matter how dumb it is. In front of me, I have a calculator that I bought for around $10, and at first glance, it might seem like an unassuming calculator. It can do advanced mathematics, but it has a secret under the hood, and we can see it if we swipe down from the top. This calculator runs on Android, and that means we can probably hack it to run games. The first thing that we need to do in this quest is to set this up with USB debugging so we can sideload some apps. With a quick swipe from the top, we can open up the settings menu, and then we can go down to system. Here, we need to go down to about tablet, and then we need to tap the build number a bunch of times to enable the developer options. After we do that, we can head over to the new developer options menu, and we can turn on USB debugging. One of the first problems that we need to fix is the fact that we don't have a normal home launcher on this calculator. Let's fix that. After we press the home button again, we can now pick the ATV launcher from the menu to break out of this calculator application. Now we're able to get a closer look at the apps that this thing already had installed by default, but we need to add a bunch of other things to achieve our goal of memeing this into an emulation device. First, I need to see what we're working with, and we can install Ada 64 to get a better look at our stats. In here, we can see that this is an all-winner A50 processor, which is an older 32-bit processor, but we do have 1 GB of RAM, which is a lot more than I was expecting to see on a purpose-built product like this. One unfortunate thing here is that our internal storage is a bit on the small side, so I hope that we can use a USB drive to expand our storage. We have enough storage space here for our apps and emulators, but we don't have a lot for our ROMs. I've read online that this thing has an internal SD card slot, but I will need to open this up to get a look at it. All in all, not a bad configuration for a calculator. We've got a rooted system running on Android 9, and the thermals don't seem bad so far. It's also pretty cool that this thing has full touchscreen support, which is a nice fallback option for emulation. Off camera, I need to install the emulators that I need for this video, and I need to add some ROMs. Not really sure what this guy can do, since this is a new processor for me, but it should be good enough for some N64, Dreamcast, and maybe some light PSP. Before that, we still have some other specs that we need to uncover, and that means we need to open this thing up. Okay, now that we finally have the back shell off, we can see the internal components. For the amount of empty space that we have here, this is a smallish battery at 2,700 mAh. We definitely have more space for a much bigger battery if we wanted to go through the work of sourcing one and hooking it up to the PCB. I think the interesting thing here is that we essentially have a PCB from something like a tablet that appears to have been repurposed into a calculator. You can see that we have the original power buttons and the volume buttons on the side, and these are things that you can't really get to unless you open this up. Kind of a cool way to recycle some older hardware that was probably collecting dust on a shelf. With the CPU shield off, we have a full view of our processor and a couple of other chips. I think this is our Wi-Fi and Bluetooth chip, and these might be our RAM, but I'm not sure. Anyway, I've gone ahead and installed a bunch of other stuff, but I do have some unfortunate news that I found out after some additional digging. If we go into this tester application, I was hoping that these calculator keys would generate a key code. If they did generate one, that would mean that they could be mapped inside emulators. As you can see, none of these generate a code, and that is really unfortunate because I was looking forward to using these buttons here to play some simple games. That means our only way to play games on this now would be to use touch or if we connect a controller to this. Outside of that, I did find out that the SD card slot does not work. I tried about 10 cards or so in all kinds of different formats and nothing is recognized with this slot. The good part though is that the USB port can do USB mass storage, so we can use an SD card adapter or a USB drive. Since I already had an SD card prepped and ready, I'm going to use that with an adapter because my internal storage is almost gone at this point. Just to kind of make this a bit easier to use, I've also gone through the process of adding a front end to this with the games that I want to test in this video. For my controller, I'm using an SN30 Pro connected via Bluetooth, but I would probably go ahead and use a hardwired approach to improve latency. This is an older chip after all. But yeah, that means we're finally ready to test this thing out. We're gonna start off on the lower end with NES. I've got RoboCop 3 here for our first title, and this thing is obviously gonna run as well as you would expect. I have also set the CPU clocks to the maximum, but it's not something that we need for these lower end systems. Now I am noticing that we do have a bit of stutter in these light games, and I'm not really sure what's causing this, but I am seeing it in a few other systems outside of NES. For example, here's Game Boy with Metroid 2, and it also has some slight stuttering, but this is something that shouldn't happen with this processor. When we move up to Game Boy Advance, we need to use a lighter GBA core because our processor is a bit on the low side, but we can play these games. The issue is that we now have the occasional stutter and some dips in performance just from these games being a bit demanding. After testing this, I did go back and disable VSync in RA, and that seems to have improved things a bit, but I won't have that disabled for the other RA systems that I already filmed. So we do have that same stuttering, but it's not that obvious in certain games that don't have a lot of action, like Pokemon, for example. Super Nintendo was another system that I wanted to take a look at. This processor is a bit on the weak side, but we do have an emulator that we can use in RA. The only downside is that it does have a lot of wonky stuff to it, but the 2002 core can run some of these heavier titles like Super Mario World, but again, we do have that same stuttering. When we go to Super Mario World 2, this is kind of the pinnacle of Super Nintendo emulation on chips like this, and it's running without a hitch. This is a good sign, and this is a title that I usually use to benchmark, but there are other heavy titles too. We're kind of going in terms of emulation demand, and our next system up from here is actually DS with the Drastic emulator. We have Frameskip enabled without enhanced 3D resolution, but it's performing pretty well, and I'm not seeing the stuttering that I'm seeing in RA in this emulator. If I were to enable the enhanced 3D rendering option, or if I turned off auto frameskip, these games would run a lot slower, so these are the settings that I needed to use on this device. For Nintendo 64, we need to use a standalone emulator since that one gave the best performance and we're able to get some decent performance out of the titles that I was testing. Obviously, an A7 processor is not going to be enough to play the full catalog of N64 games, but the usual light ones are not a problem. The cool thing here is that these games are running at native resolution, which is something that you don't usually see on weak hardware like this. Even games like Star Fox 64 run pretty well with some dips here in this first level, but it's still highly playable on this calculator. I mean, what more could you expect for $10? This thing is already a lot better than I expected when I bought this as a joke. But when it comes to Diddy Kong Racing, this game ran a bit slower than I thought. I've tested this on other A7 processors with a slightly different GPU than this, and it runs better on those processors than it is here. It might be due to the GPU. Now we're in the systems that don't run that well, and Dreamcast is the first one. We really don't have the performance here to play Dreamcast games except for these light ones. This is Power Stone with Frameskip enabled, and it's kind of chugging along here with some audio crackle. Surprisingly, PS1 is actually pretty bad on this calculator, and now that I'm saying that out loud, it even seems stupid. Anyway, we're using RA again for this, but I would expect that we could get better performance if we used a standalone emulator. These first two titles aren't that bad with the same dips down to 56 FPS that we can see in other systems, but when we go to a heavier game that should run on a 1.5 GHz processor like this, we are underperforming. Tekken 3 has a huge FPS drop down to 46, which is way lower than it should be, since this is a game that can run full speed on other A7 processors that don't even have a GPU. As you would expect by now, this processor is not really good enough for PSP. We're starting off here with a 3D based game, and it's kind of chugging along even though we have auto frameskip enabled. There are two ways to look at this. Obviously, it's pretty cool that this is even playing at all, but it's not really practical like the other systems were. These 3D titles like Kingdom Hearts are really slow, and it's not really a good experience. Even 2D games like Final Fantasy can have some slowdowns that I didn't expect to see based on my experience with other processors that also use a Cortex A7. So I originally set the goal of trying to get this to run Half-Life 2, but I switched to Doom 3 because I didn't have enough space for the Half-Life 2 files. It probably doesn't even matter because our CPU is on the low end for a gaming device, as is our GPU. Anyway, here's Doom 3. I mean, we're running. We're running at more FPS than you probably thought was possible on a calculator. There are times when we can divide our FPS in half and still have a double digit number, so that's pretty cool. If it's good enough for the Switch, it's good enough for my $10 calculator. To make this game playable, we need to turn off a lot of graphical settings, which kind of makes this game look like a Dreamcast port, but we are able to play it. I mean, it's fully playable at this point in the game. I can't speak for later on. Right now, I'm using a controller to play this game, and we do have some dips here and there. If we decrease the resolution a bit, the game looks a lot worse than this, and a lot of the black textures that you can see off in the distance show up a lot closer to the character, but the game runs a bit faster. It just makes the game look like a DOS port, so I didn't want to do it for this video. I did want to have at least one example in this video of playing something handheld. So here we are playing Doom 3 with touch control enabled. The odd thing that I need to point out here about Doom 3 is that it does have some sluggish performance when you fire a gun. When you fire, the FPS takes a dive and it kind of enables like a bullet time mode, which makes it easier and more difficult to play at the same time. Like if you want to get a precise headshot, the bullet time thing really helps because the entire thing runs like a slideshow, but I found that some of these mobs don't want to die when I shoot them. I think they know that I'm playing this on a calculator and they don't want to die a humiliating death. I'll also occasionally fat finger the in-game calculator, which doesn't help things. But yeah, this is Doom 3 running on a calculator and it definitely fulfills the can it run Doom meme, right? I have to say that I'm really impressed by the thermal performance of this thing. Even with the CPU clocks locked to max, we never really go up that high on this and it doesn't feel that hot to hold in the hand. But I wasn't happy with ending the meme stream at Doom 3, so we're gonna increase it all the way up to Doom Eternal. Obviously, this thing is an Android device, and we can stream whatever we want to it with Steam Link. I think this is simultaneously the dumbest purchase that I've ever made, while also being something that is really impressive for $10. It's not the best quality, but it is playable. I mean, I am playing it, so what more could you ask? But yeah, I hope you enjoyed this random video. This was a pretty cool find, but it's not really practical to go out and buy this. I think the price is a lot higher than $10 now, but it was $10 when I got it. If you enjoyed this video and you want to see another, take a look at a video that I did on a portable Wii handheld that also looks like a giant PSP. Happy gaming, everyone. Taki out.